This video is brought to you by MyWayTeaching.com.
Simple harmonic motion. How small should be the amplitude be? When you perform any experiment to determine the time period of a simple pendulum, usually it is always what we do is we keep the amplitude small. Then how much it should be, whether it should be 5 degree, 2 degree, 1 degree, 0.5 degree, or it could be 10 degree, 20 degree or 30 degree. How much small should we keep the amplitude in simple harmonic motion? See, it is better to measure the time period for different amplitudes up to large amplitudes. For large oscillations, we have to take care that the pendulum oscillates in a vertical plane. And let us denote the time period of the small amplitude oscillations as T, and write the time period for amplitude as theta naught as T of theta naught. That is equal to C into T of 0. Where C is the multiplying factor, and then you have to plot the graph of C versus theta naught. Then we get the values like this. For different values of theta naught, the C will be like this: 20 degree, 45 degree, 50 degree, 70 degree, 90 degree, 1.02, 1.04, 1.05, 1.1 and 1.8. These are the values that we get for different values of theta. This means that the error in the time period is about 2% at an amplitude of 20 degree, and it is 5% for an amplitude of 50 degree, and it is 10% at an amplitude of 70 degree, and 18% at an amplitude of 90 degree, isn't it? So here you will be able to measure T of 0 because this means there are no oscillations. Sine theta is exactly equal to theta theoretically only for theta is equal to 0. There will, isn't it? Because theta will be very small and there will be some inaccuracy for all the other values of theta. The difference increases with increasing theta. So therefore, we have to decide how much error we can tolerate. No measurement is ever perfectly accurate. And even you should consider the some of the things while calculating this, like what is the accuracy of the stopwatch, what is your own accuracy in starting and stopping the stopwatch. The accuracy in your measurement at this level is never better than 5% or 10%. Since the above table that we saw shows that the time period of the pendulum increases hardly by 5% at an amplitude of 50 degree over its low amplitude value, you could very well keep the amplitude to be 50 degree. Okay. If you keep the amplitude 50 degree, that will be a very good amplitude for the measurement purpose. Now let us see one simple example. What is the length of a simple pendulum which ticks seconds? So now find the solution for this. See, we know the equation for the time period of the simple pendulum, isn't it? We derived it. That is t is equal to 2 pi square root of L by g. And from this, since here what we want is length, so we can take out of this length. So first let us do squaring on both the side. And let us take L outside. We get L is equal to t square g by 4 pi square. Isn't it? And the time period of a simple pendulum which ticks seconds is 2 seconds. Therefore, g is equal to 9.8 meter per second square. We'll take t as 2 seconds. And then we'll get the value of L. So let us substitute the values. That is t square 2 square g is 9.8 by 4 pi square. So we get 1 meter. The value of L, that is the length of a simple pendulum. Okay. Now let us study about damped simple harmonic motion. Till now we studied about simple harmonic motion. So now we are going to study damped simple harmonic motion. Okay. And we know that the motion of a simple pendulum swinging in air dies out eventually, which means after some interval of time or after time, obviously that motion will stop. What is the reason for that? This is because the air drag and the friction at the support oppose the motion of the pendulum. Air drag in the atmosphere as well as the friction at the support. So these two will oppose the motion of the pendulum and dissipate its energy gradually. So the pendulum is set to execute damped oscillations. In damped oscillations, the energy of the system is dissipated continuously, but for small damping, the oscillations remain approximately periodic. Even though the energy dissipates continuously, but those oscillations will remain periodic. And the dissipating forces are generally the frictional forces. So, for understanding purpose, let us consider a system. As you can see in this figure, here a block of mass M is connected to an elastic spring of spring constant K, which oscillates vertically. This is the block of mass M, which is connected to a spring with spring constant K. If the block is pushed down a little and then if it is released, then its angular frequency of oscillation that is given by W is equal to square root of K by M, isn't it? As we saw in the previous equations. Usually, the surrounding medium will exert a damping force. The surrounding means that air drag, isn't it? That air drag will exert the damping force on the motion of the block, and the mechanical energy of the block spring system will decrease. The energy loss will appear as heat of the surrounding medium. See, the damping force, it depends on the nature of the surrounding medium. If the block is immersed in a liquid, then the magnitude of the damping will be much greater than the dissipation of the energy much faster. The damping force is generally proportional to velocity of the bob. Okay, it is usually it is proportional to velocity of the bob. And it acts opposite to the direction of velocity. If we denote the damping force by Fd, then we can write it as minus B into V. Where the positive constant B, it depends on the characteristics of the medium, for example, viscosity and the size and shape of the block. And this equation, it is usually valid for small velocity. Okay, when the mass M is attached to the spring and when it is released, that spring will elongate a little and the mass will settle at some height. So that is shown by the point O in this figure. You can see here at this point. This is the equilibrium position of the mass. If that mass it is pulled down or pushed up a little, the restoring force on the block due to the spring, that restoring force on the block due to the spring is given by Fs, that is minus K into X, where X is the displacement of the mass from its equilibrium position. So the total force acting on the mass at any time t is given by F is equal to minus Kx minus Bv. If A of t is the acceleration of the mass at time t, then we can write from the Newton's law of motion, which is applied along the direction of motion. So we can write F as M into A of t, where A of t is acceleration of mass at the time t, that is given by minus kx minus x of t, b into b of t. See, using the first and second derivatives of x of t for v of t and A of t respectively, we can write M into d square x by dt square plus b dx by dt plus kx in so equal to 0. So this equation describes the motion of the block under the influence of a damping force which is proportional to velocity. The solution we get will be in the form that is x of t is equal to a into e raised to minus bt by 2m cos w dash into t plus pi, where a is the amplitude and w dash is the angular frequency of the damped oscillator, and that is given by square root of k by m minus b square by 4 m square. Okay, the cosine function has a period 2 pi by w dash, but the function x of t is not strictly periodic because of this exponential factor e raised to minus bt by 2m. So because of this exponential factor, this x of t is not periodic because this exponential function decreases continuously with the time. If the decrease is small in one time period t, the motion represented by the equation, that is x of t equation, is approximately periodic. The solution for this x of t equation, it is represented graphically as you can see here. As a cosine function whose amplitude is given by a e raised to minus bt by 2m, and it gradually decreases with time. Mechanical energy of the undamped oscillator is given by 1 by 2 ka square. For a damped oscillator, amplitude is not constant, it depends on time. For a small damping, we may use the same expression but regard the amplitude as a into e raised to minus bt by 2m. We can use the same expression like 1 by 2k and we'll represent the amplitude as a square e raised to minus bt m. So this gives the total energy of the system. It also decreases exponentially with time. For small damping means that the dimensionless ratio, that is b by root k m, is much less than 1. Okay. If you put b is equal to 0, all equations of the damped oscillator reduce to the corresponding equations of the undamped oscillator.